welcome to a brand new episode of Trader Babes. Tonight, we will be talking with two female traders who are taking the FinTwit world by storm. And we will be talking to them about the current market, what trades they're taking, and answering the questions you submitted to us on Twitter at Trader Babes. But first, I want to say hello to my lovely co-host, Aria. Hi, Aria. How are you?
I'm doing good. Arika, how are you? I'm very excited for this.
I know, me too. It's our first female guest. We have two of them. So it's a very special episode. And I say we just get right into it. You ready?
I can't wait. Let's go.
So our first guest is Meg. You know her as Miss Meg Trades on Twitter. And we also have Rafaela. She is known as at the Girl Trader on Twitter. So let's bring them in and say hello. Hey, how are you?
Good. Hi. How are you?
Thank you so much for being with us tonight. We are so excited. You are our first female guest we've had on Trader Babes. And not only do we have one, we have both of you. So it's going to be such a special episode, and we can't wait to hear your guys' perspectives on everything.
Likewise.
Having us.
Yeah, I think Rafaela and I are definitely excited to be with you guys today.
Good, good. I think that the first thing, of course, we want to talk about is the market right now. We are seeing so much chop, and it is not easy out there. What are you guys seeing?
Well, we definitely saw a lot of weakness today, and I'd love to hear from Meg and Rafaela about it as well. Everything looks overextended for sure, and low volume, and today there was definitely some indications of a possible pullback. So what do you think, Meg?
It's tough to say. Sorry, excuse my dogs in the background, but it's tough to say because, you know, I've been feeling like there's going to be a pullback for a while now, and we just haven't necessarily seen like a large pullback. It just kind of feels like a slow bleeding. But, you know, I want to kind of be hopeful and think that it's going to reverse soon, but it's probably terrible to say, but I hope we see just kind of a big rug pull and then we all just start fresh rather than having the slow bleed.
It's almost better just to get it over with, right?
Yeah, yeah. Like, let's not prolong it anymore. I think it's just going to be best for everyone. Like, just pick a direction.
And do you agree, Rafaela? What are you seeing and kind of what are you hoping for?
So actually last week I started hedging my long-term positions because I noticed that SPY was making like an all-time high on like the lowest volume we've seen in a while. So I was kind of expecting a pullback. So I started hedging my positions then. I think it's a small pullback, but I'm not too sure. Hopefully like we get some more volume in small caps and hopefully it stops getting killed.
Yeah, you bring up a good point because we are not seeing volume in penny land whatsoever. Whenever we get runners, it's kind of a pop and fade right now. And we weed stocks were supposed to be running this week. That didn't happen. Aria was actually looking at these today, considering it's 4:20. And what did you see, Aria?
Yeah, today I was actually trying to trade on my phone, which is a big no-no. So I just looked at pretty much the line chart when TLRY was at -8 and it looked like it was going to bounce. It was like 15 something, close to 16. And I just entered. And then when I got home, like 5 minutes later, I looked at the daily chart of TLRY and I noticed that I would have never gone into this dip by if I was at my desk and saw the daily chart, because as we know, 200 moving average is probably the strongest moving average you can bet on. And it literally had broken that moving average. So that's not where I ever want to trade. When I trade at my desk, if even if it's a day trade, I always check the daily chart to just make sure it's on a some kind of a support or a healthy trend. And, you know, that goes to say, like, you know, never have too much ego. You gotta always do what you do as you plan. But it, thank God it wasn't a loss or anything, because I had a very tight stop loss, very small position.
Yeah, and I know, Rafael, you said you were hedging positions last week. Did you have any weed names in your positions list?
So, no, I didn't. I thought it was just like everyone was expecting it to go up 420. I mean, when I see that and when I see like all of FinTwit expecting something, I usually don't want to like go into it or don't want to go into anything too hyped up, just because we really don't know like what's going to happen. So I didn't really go into it. I stayed in cash mostly, and I've just been scalping like large caps because I think we're seeing like a money flowing into large caps rather than small caps, obviously. Like names like Apple, NVIDIA, Microsoft, for example. So it was easier to scalp those rather than swinging like small caps. They've been getting crushed recently. So, yeah.
And Meg, did you have any weed stocks in your portfolio? Excuse me. And what are you trading right now?
So I thought the same. I knew there was going to be a lot of hype. It's almost kind of like earnings, you know, and I thought the same with, you know, Dodge, with the whole 420. And I think there was definitely a lot of hype, and it was kind of like a sell the news. It wasn't the day to buy. It was really the prior days leading up to today that was the time to buy. So I didn't, you know, I didn't want to swing anything, or everything's kind of been a little bit risky. So I just was trying to avoid it altogether. But I've just been sculpting to just a couple of small caps, but I am really just in and out. I take small percentages, you know, whether it's like between 2 or 5%, I'll take it. It just gives me peace of mind. And then I move on and just keep stop losses tight. And that's kind of worked for me. I feel more peace of mind before things start to heat up again.
That's probably the best strategy right now, because crypto market, penny stock, everything seems to be on sort of a waiting period. Everybody right. wants to know. And that's probably the best thing to do. And, you know, if there is going to be a rug pull on spy, like I always say, a close below the 50 moving average and next day continuation is definitely a signal to go all short, but otherwise it's probably best to just wait all this out or scalp, like, you know.
Yeah, and you mentioned the Doji or Dodge or however we pronounce it cryptocurrency, and the hype around that, the hype around weed stocks. Just kind of wanted to ask both of you, I guess we can start with Meg first. What sort of sentiment are you seeing across Twitter and across the different social platforms that you talk to traders on?
Regarding crypto or just like
the everything, like what are people trading? Are they identifying the same chop? Are they still going through and searching for what to trade, trying to force trades? Kind of what are you hearing?
I feel like just based on, you know, my groups of trader friends that I have, they're kind of, because the market has just not been great, they're trying to find other avenues, for instance, trading crypto, moving more towards OTC, SafeMoon, that's like the latest craze. So it's almost like they're trying to just, they're not seeing it work in the market right now. So they're exploring other avenues, which I think is great. Like I've personally tried to get more into OTC. It's a whole different ball game, but I figured, you know, I'm not going to be actively trading the market right now. So I may as well learn something new, which I've seen a lot of people are doing, like trying new things that they maybe weren't going to try before.
Yeah, trying to adapt to the market changes.
Yeah, yeah.
And Rafael, are you seeing the same? A lot of people changing up what they're doing right now?
Yeah, so I kind of agree with that. I noticed like a negative sentiment among traders on finance Twitter, just because small caps have been getting crushed. But I've noticed how like retail traders and newbies are trying to like chase the next big thing. And I guess like Doji and crypto, they thought like, okay, people are making insane gains and I'm not making anything trading stocks. So let me try and chase Doji, like chase SafeMoon, for example, when it's like up over 300%. I think in the past week, past month, I don't know, but it's kind of insane how like people are chasing these stocks.
They're still chasing like the same, they're chasing the idea of a penny runner or another GameStop, right?
Right, right. So they think like, let me find the next big squeeze or, and they found Doji, so.
Yeah, and Doji is one of the worst to end up holding a bag, and I feel really bad for, you know, traders who just come into this, because that just reminds me of who, you know, how I used to trade years ago. So, you know, just be very careful if you're a new trader out there. You know, if you're holding Doge for a year, that's fine, I guess, you know, but like don't go in, buy the high, sell the low, panic. You know, it's just not where you want to be unless you really believe in Doge for some reason. And then in that case, just hold it.
Yeah, and that brings up a good point, newer traders. When you were first starting out, did you make the same mistakes of trying to chase things? Kind of walk us through how you started trading. We'll start with Rafaela first.
Yeah, so 100%. That's actually one of my biggest mistakes. So what I did when I first started trading was I went on Twitter and I started following these accounts. And I was thinking like, you know what, they're experienced. Like I'll just follow blindly. And like there's obviously people who alert their plays. So I was thinking like, okay, let me just go into their plays and see what happens. That was the biggest mistake I've ever made. Like I chased stocks that were up tremendously. And I lost like 80% of my port because of that. So I'm like, there's definitely, this is not working out. Like I need to figure out, I need to do something else. So I tried learning charts, learning option flow, and that changed the game for me. Like I don't follow other people's plays anymore. I do my own due diligence, which is very important. I think people who go on Twitter look at people pumping up plays and they're like, okay, let me get in now. But have you looked into the company? Like you need to do your own due diligence when it comes to that. So I think that's important.
Yeah, and I feel like a lot of seasoned traders try preaching that a lot because we see so many people making that mistake. I made that mistake, following blindly, not even knowing if it was a swing trade or a day trade when I first started out. So I completely know what you mean. Did you do the same thing, Meg?
Yeah, I definitely had what was called beginner's luck. When I started trading last year, I started trading in a bull market and it was mainly options. So, I mean, if that tells you anything, it was insane returns.
You started off in options, not even in stocks?
Yeah, I mean, and it wasn't necessarily by choice. I didn't really even know what the market was. I had one of my friends show me his Robinhood account and was like, look at this. And I was like, what are you doing, you know? And I kind of followed blindly, and I didn't start with a lot of money, but I followed blindly and started in a bull market, and I just was seeing gain after gain. And I was like, this is so easy. You know, like I think a lot of people start that way. They're like, wow, like, why didn't I learn this before? Then August and September came, and that's when I kind of had my little humbling, you know, and I was like, oh man, I actually need to study. So really, I think just a lot of people get caught in beginner's luck. I was one of them. And you really do have to study. It's just like, I've seen a lot of traders compare it to like, you go to college, you study for 4 years to go and do a job, right? It's just like trading is the same. You've got to pay like your tuition to some extent. It's not just gonna, you're not just gonna wake up and be like an excellent trader. So I think just really studying helped me a lot.
Yeah, definitely. It's important what you said, because it is like paying for tuition when you're losing money. But I also like to add on that you don't want to keep flunking out of whatever university you're paying tuition, because you're going to come out at the end, if you don't study, you know, just with a bunch of student loans or, you know, debt. So sure, like, don't get down on those accounts you end up blowing a couple times, but if you're not changing anything, nothing will change, and you're just basically flunking your way out of a university paying tuition, whereas you knew right away that this means I gotta study.
Yeah, definitely.
And you said you started with options, and I know now you trade equities and options. Do you have a preference of one over the other?
You know, I really started liking equities and small caps more this year. I'd never really traded it before. So it was more so, I was mainly options. And then I kind of started to get the hang of small caps. And I think, you know, I think it's very dependent on personality, like different trading styles. I think small caps is better for my personality. You know, options, there's a lot you've got to factor in. And I think if you're like more of, you would think they're both risky, but for me, I feel sometimes like options is a little bit more risky because, you know, you've got time decay, etc. So for me, I just have more peace of mind sometimes trading small caps. And I guess I prefer it, but I still now and then would trade options, but small caps has definitely become more of my thing lately.
And Rafaela, do you have a preference between the two?
So I mostly trade options. I just like it. I guess, like, for me, I'm more of like the riskier kind of trader. So I don't mind options too much, just because, and also the returns are insane if you're on the right side of the trade. But now I've just been scalping mostly, and obviously taking profits like way sooner than I used to. Because when I would swing, I would obviously wait for a bigger return, but I just enjoy options better, I guess.
So you're day trading options right now, you're scalping them?
Yeah, for now.
I do the same. I like day trading options as well. So I understand the appeal, absolutely. And when you first started, you started in small caps, or how did you land on options?
So I actually also started with options, started trading options at first, because I was starting with a smaller account. And I noticed how options, like, you can grow a smaller account easier. So yeah, I started with that. And also, I also had beginner's luck. I mean, no, I lost 80% of my portfolio. And then after that, I made one profitable trade that really like changed everything. It really like it. After that one trade, I learned a lot from my losses, from my gains. So.
And did you start off in like any trading groups, any discords? Were you on StockTwits to begin with?
So I started off joining two trading groups. One of them completely like helped with my mindset, and one of them helped with just answering all my questions. There was an education section where I learned everything from there. So both both of them helped me a lot. The first one, named The Corporation. So I actually joined their Discord at the very beginning, and the owner, or the person who created the Discord, his name is Final, and he told me, he's like, Raph, your intuition. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, I never follow my intuition. He's like, once you start following your intuition, you'll become a successful trader. And I really thought about it. And right before my most successful trade, I was like, I remembered his words, and I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna follow my intuition. And that led me to my best trade I've ever made. So I really thank him for that one. And the second Discord that I joined when I first started trading was Market Masters. So there's three traders, Mini Trades, Flooded, and King Zig. They've helped me tremendously with all my questions when I first joined. And they have an education section for free. So I learned everything from them, from YouTube videos, trading terms, and basically they answered every single question that I had. I would bother them all the time. So I thank them during my trading journey, definitely.
And how about you, Meg? Did you start off in any Discord groups or trading groups?
Yeah, so I can't say I necessarily had one that was a huge game changer for me. I feel like I kind of hop in between many. I don't know, maybe I'm just I want kind of a different variety. But I must say, in each Discord that I've been in, I feel like maybe I speak for everyone, in every Discord there is, it's different. There's almost a different culture to every Discord. And I would always, I wanted to find as much educational material as possible. So I was just joining multiple Discords and kind of seeing what material they had, because it was free. However, though, when I started, I would pay for Discords, and I mean I wouldn't name the Discords, but I do think that was a time where I was getting caught in kind of groups that would take advantage, so I then discovered Twitter and FinTwit, and was like, wow, all the stuff I've been paying for all along is for free. I didn't even realize that's for free on all these Discords. So I was kind of it was a rude awakening, because I felt taken advantage of, and it changed things a lot for me, because I learned the most. I kind of learned not to be a sheep and to go out and do my own research within different Discords, look at the educational material, meet other successful traders, which is awesome. Meeting other traders has really helped me a lot, because, like we've spoken about before, it can be lonely if you're just trading by yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. And you bring up a good point about the fact that there are a lot of traps that newer traders can get caught in that aren't necessarily reliable resources. And I also feel like it can be hard when you're bouncing around trying to find your place. Aria and I were just talking about this on our last episode. Things that we encountered when we first started Discord, weren't we, Aria?
Right. which aspect of it?
No, just the different kinds of comments that you would get, and criticism. Did you guys face any backlash because you were a girl on Twitter or Discord? Did you guys have to kind of go through any nightmarish DMs? We'll start with Rafaela.
Yeah, it's been wild. The things I've been seeing on Twitter, people calling me catfish, people saying go on, stay on OnlyFans. I received a troll. He came and he commented something on my Twitter yesterday, which I thought was insane. I actually took a picture of it. I'm just fine.
Put it on blast. Let's see it.
I couldn't even believe what I read. So he's like, chicks that look like her end up with losers or nobody at all frequently because they think they are too good. Loads of them pass up really great guys and end up old with regrets.
So someone obviously screwed him over and he's taking it out on you.
It's insane. I couldn't believe what I read. Like, that was word for word. Like, I'm like, how can someone assume something like that just from looking at a profile picture of a girl? Like, you have no idea who I am. How could you possibly be saying something like that? And I think it's extremely hard. People say, like, ignore your trolls. Like, it's hard for me to just ignore that and not say anything. But I've been really trying to work on it, like blocking out all the hate, blocking like all the nasty and rude comments. So,
you know, this
all seems like a projection. The same way we sometimes project our feelings or how we feel in the market. They say your worst enemy is you when you're trading. It is true. And like when you know your technicals and you enter and you still mess up, it's really due to you projecting some deeper emotions of either lack and so on. It's the same exact way when you see a rude comment, whether you're a woman or a man to man, it's literally nothing other than how they feel inside about themselves. Somebody who's happy inside, they would never make that comment about a woman or a man.
Yeah, that's true. And another point of it though, I have to say, is I think that we're all used to trash talk between traders. It happens. In any kind of industry you're in, when you have colleagues, you know, you'll maybe kind of poke fun at each other. But talking about her looks and his comment has absolutely nothing to do with trading or the stock market. It's just like, it's like those things you just don't even understand, like, what's the point of even saying it? And you're right. Yeah, it's a projection of their own inside feelings. And for whatever reason, they feel like they are entitled to take it out on unsuspecting women on Twitter. What have you experienced, Meg?
I guess like one of my, it was so funny. I had a guy message me and say, shame on you for using another girl's photos. And I was like, excuse me, it's me. Like, and I tried to reason. I was like, the irony is, it is actually me. And they were like, shame on you. You're probably an old man and you're using another girl's photos for clout and you should be ashamed. And I'm like, bye.
Girls can't trade. Pretty smart girls can't trade.
Well, it's funny because I didn't realize like how few females trade, or, you know, I didn't realize that was necessarily like a thing till this year, to be honest.
Yeah, yeah, and I think that it's almost like a pickup line or something, like trying to get you to talk to them. That's so strange. I mean, do you guys get a lot of like DMs of guys trying to hit on you?
Yeah, for sure. I get a lot of funny pickup lines. I think the funniest one was someone DM me, I'm gonna complain to Spotify because you're not showing up on this week's hottest singles. That actually made me
laugh. Okay. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. What have you seen, Meg? Have you gotten any funny ones like that?
Nothing funny, to be honest. Like a lot of like, you know, do you want to go on dates? Like, if I make you laugh, can we go on a date? Do you want to FaceTime? I'm like, not really. But I mean, it's for most part, I haven't really received anything like extremely inappropriate, which has been nice. I feel like the moment, you know, I've seen trolls kind of being bashed and it being spoken about, it's been less. At a stage, I could definitely tell, like, I would get the odd comment here or there that was just not nice. And it was a little tough because I'd never really put myself like in a spotlight in this kind of matter. So I wasn't used to it. But ever since, you know, we are talking about it more, it's almost gone. I haven't really had anything, touch wood, happen for a couple of weeks.
Yeah, I think we have seen a decrease in it the more that people are speaking out against it. I definitely still get the messages to quite a variety of different ones. And it's funny that we bring up pickup lines, because when we had the Twitter question for what to ask you girls, I think Rafaela, your secret admirer, not so secret admirer, Mo, wants to know if you love him.
Yeah, I mentioned him. He also asked, I believe there was like two questions that he asked after that, but I get loads of those like all the time, like let's get married, or it's like the craziest things, like I'm in love with you. Like, do you even know me? It's honestly hilarious.
Yeah, it really is. And I mean, yeah, you're right. He did have a few genuine questions to ask. Why don't we start off with Aria? Will you go off of our first Twitter question?
Rafaela, if you could give advice to the new trader you, what would you give? What would you say to you?
So if I had to give advice to the new trader me, I would definitely say to learn from your losses. Buy a trading journal, write down, at the end of the day, write down, like, you're basically write down every single trade, what went wrong, what went right, and start building off of that. And another thing I would say is do not overtrade. I think most of us have, it's hard for us to just sit there and not do anything. So that's something I have to work on. And it's something I've been working on. Like, so don't go into a trade just because you're bored. That's like a good way of losing money. So yeah, that's definitely something I would tell a new trader. Also FOMO. FOMO is your worst enemy. Don't get FOMO and get into a trade that's up like 200% or even like 50%. Like, don't get into it. Just wait for another trade. There's so many other stocks you can get into. So FOMO is huge and something like that definitely needs to be worked on for a lot of traders.
And I think a lot of even successful traders have to fight that. You know, the FOMO and not to trade, they have to constantly, you know, be acknowledged of their feelings, whether how they feel on that day, whether they should trade or not. It's something you must continue to learn to trust, and that's the only way to not wreck the ship.
And another thing, when we were speaking before, Rafaela, you were talking about how important it is to have good risk management. What is it that you kind of want to tell newer traders about risk management?
So I think using stop losses, definitely important. When you get into a trade, make sure you also have a price target of when you want to get in and like when you want to get out of the trade, just so that you don't, like it reaches that price target and then it just ends up dropping after that. Now you're like a bag holder. So have like a mental price target, or even set up like a limit sell. I think you can do that. Something that, so you're not left just being a bag holder and you don't like keep losing on trades. Also, definitely don't go all into a position. I feel like some people just go into like small caps, for example, and go like in crazy, which is insane. like risk 1%, 2% of your one getting into trades, I think is important.
Absolutely, I agree with you. You know, YOLOing is fun, but not when it's your whole account. Like my rule is to never put up more than what I'm willing to lose. Do you kind of abide by the same thing?
Yeah, definitely the saying, don't risk what you can't afford is that's important. Like definitely you don't want to be stuck losing almost half your portfolio just because you were chasing a trade or you just went in blindly. So I think that's important.
And for our next Twitter question, Aria, would you like to do the honors again?
I'd love to. I wanted to ask you guys, I'm also interested to know, what are your trading goals? So are you, Rafaela, are you planning to become the next Cathie Wood? Are you trying to, you know, make enough to start your own business? What are your trading goals?
So my goals, honestly, when I first got into trading, I just wanted to become financially independent. Like I refused to work for anybody. I just didn't like the fact of like being there 9 to 5. That's probably why I got into trading in the first place. Another goal is to help my family. So that was something that motivated me. Also, I'd like to probably get into real estate later on once I make enough, maybe allocate some of it there. So yeah.
That's cool. A lot of good traders do that, actually.
Yeah, I think actually Meg and I were just talking about that last week, about how it's so good to have different types of investments. And I think real estate investments are huge. And I loved your answer, by the way, how you were like, I refuse to work for anyone else. Like when you say it with conviction like that, I feel like you're even more determined to definitely achieve that goal.
Nice.
Yeah, that motivated me for sure.
And how about you, Meg? What are your trading goals?
So I guess just like everyone, you know, the goal is financial freedom. I'm in no hurry though. I just started my career in technology. So I'm kind of I know that's a lot different because some people don't want a career necessarily. But I genuinely, like, I studied, you know, for over 4 years. So I definitely want to go and do a little bit for a couple of years and branch into that. And, you know, I want to kind of use trading as just like a supplement to my income. I enjoy it. I really do enjoy trading. You know, it's like, the money is great, but it's probably one of the things that I've like, you know, it's like a hobby for me. I guess that's my hobby. I really like trading. And like you, I want to get into real estate. I've already kind of started. So I think my key is really just to have multiple streams of income. And if it turns into anything more, and who knows, maybe a couple of years down the line, I'm like, okay, you know, I think I want to go full time. That'll be awesome.
Yeah. And I think that with any job that you're enjoying, any career path that you truly enjoy, it's less work. How you bring up, like, it's not as much about the money because you actually enjoy it. So it doesn't seem as big of a task, right?
Yep, that is true.
And did you guys have any influential people in your life that helped you want to get into trading? We'll start with Rafaela again.
So there's one person that really inspired me to get into trading. So before I started trading, I used to work at a restaurant, and there was this one man who always came in, an older man, and he came in almost every day. And one day he came up to me and he's like, how old are you? And I was 20 at the time. So I answered 20. He's like, you're very young. You need to start investing your money. you need to start learning how to trade. He's like, I'll even give you $10,000 to start trading. I need you to start. And I thought he was crazy. I was like, what is he saying? I think I'm okay with my job right now. But then COVID happened and I really thought about it. I'm like, you know what? Now that I have more time, let me start, like, I want to start learning. So I went on YouTube. I went into trading groups and I just started learning and learning. Literally for like 1 month straight, I didn't leave the house. And he really just inspired me to get started. So he's definitely someone that I got to give thanks to.
That's an amazing story. I love that, especially with you being so young. I feel like a lot of young adults don't necessarily think in terms of trying to make investments to, you know, for the long term. I know I'm guilty of that. I wasn't thinking like that at 20. So that's amazing that he inspired you to do that and that you actually took the advice and really put it to good use. That's awesome.
Thank you so much.
And how about you, Mick? Is there any influential person that got you into trading or that kind of gave you the idea?
Yeah, so last year, my final year of college, in one of my sales classes, it was like announced that the youngest woman on Wall Street, Lauren Simmons, she's from my university. She like had just started there. And I mean, I'm not from like a Ivy League, you know, super well-known university. It's like a normal public university. And I was kind of like, wow, that's crazy. You know, that is a huge accomplishment. And I had just started like learning how to trade too. And so, you know, for me, it was kind of like, well, if she can do it. And I mean, she was just a business management major. Nothing special, but you know, in my mind I was like, if she can do it, like I'm sure I can learn how to trade. Like how hard can this be? And if other people are making these huge goals, you know, I wanted to then set myself some goals. And that was, you know, pivotal for me.
Yeah, I love that story too, that that another young woman was your inspiration. That's amazing.
She's 22. Isn't that crazy?
Wow.
And on Wall Street, youngest female. I mean, I've tried to message her. She didn't reply.
Well, I bet she's very busy now.
Well, that's what I was like, you know what? I was like, it was worth a shot, but I was like, I had to let her know. I was like, just to let you know, like it was so cool seeing you do this. And it's definitely, it's inspired me.
Well, yeah. Maybe one day she'll be trying to interview you.
No, dream big.
There is one more question from Twitter that I'm curious to know how you go about this. Someone asked, do you use stop loss? Do you, you know, for risk management or for taking profit, given that most market makers do place stop loss, they, you know, they know what your stop loss is, and it's quite possible that they see, you know, especially if it's a large order, they come after you, kick you out of the trade and basically do what the move was supposed to do. So as a day trader, do you recommend stop loss?
And if you do use stop losses, do you use trailing stops or stop limits? Like what's your preference? We'll start with Rafaela first.
So it really depends on how volatile the stock is. So I actually use mental stop losses rather than actually using a stop loss, just because I think that works better for me. But sometimes stop losses could hurt you. I know that happens sometimes.
Because of the stop loss rates that Aria was talking about?
Right, yeah. So for now, I've just been using mental stop losses.
And would you, have you always been doing that, or did you start away from mental stop losses?
No, yeah, I recently started using stop losses. I didn't use it in the beginning.
And do you have enough discipline to
execute your stop losses?
Yeah, I mean, it's been working out fine for me, but I know for some people, they'd rather have like someone else do it for them rather than using a mental one. But for me, it's been okay.
Yeah, I think it depends on the person's level of discipline, how close they're watching a stock to. I mean, a lot of people who aren't normally active day traders can't really sit in front of the computer all day long. So I think that having the actual, you know, the hard stop, as they're called, put in place can be helpful depending on your strategy. Meg, do you use hard stops or do you have a mental stop loss? What's your take on that?
Mostly mental, but you made a really good point. If you're not going to be, you know, actively watching your screen or the stock, I definitely want to set a stop loss, because it's happened to me before where I've been like, I'm going to create a mental stop. I'll go do something. And then I come back and they announce an offering or, you know, something bad. And I'm like, man, I should have known. If I'm not going to be watching it and I'm not actively keeping track with this, I need to set stop losses. So I think just depending on like your current stage in life, you've got to decide, you know, what risk are you willing to take? And it really is dependent on like a schedule, I think, too.
Yeah. And when you do use the hard stops, do you have a preference between using a trailing stop versus a limit stop?
I usually do just like a limit stop. I try, like if I feel, you know, that my conviction didn't play out or the play's just been bad, I won't try and like fight to get back in. You know, I would rather just cut my loss. Well, there's another play. I won't try and fight my way back into a play, because I've done that before, you know, just keep adding. And then next thing you know, you should have probably cut a long time ago.
So the dreaded averaging down. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah. So I'll just like, I've gotten better at being like, okay, this is a terrible trade. Like, let me just get out. Like, yeah, we lost a little bit, but it could be more. So, and it's happened to me before where I've gotten out of something and then looked at it later and been like, I'm so glad I got out, you know? And absolutely, it's kind of reconfirms like that it is sometimes best to just leave a bad play.
Usually when a stock goes against you and it's in a downtrend, it means it's in a downtrend.
Yeah.
So, you know,
we don't like to believe
out
it
there is but screaming to get in at any pop. Meanwhile, you know, the other side might think differently, but every pop is basically a short dream to short into. So I personally, you know, I think when you lose on one trade, like one ticker, your mindset starts to change. You know, the whole revenge, the I need to be right, I really thought this is going up. I usually move on, like you said, to another ticker, because at that time I know everything's stacked up against me. If I've lost in it, I'm not thinking right.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Talking about how like psychology was a really big thing for me. When I started trading, I kind of just saw it as a numbers game and, you know, technical. But the biggest challenge for me, other than learning how to trade, was like the psychology behind it. I did not realize like how much of a mental game it is. It was a big thing. And I think that's kind of what has flipped the switch for me, was learning more the psychology side of it. And I know it gets spoken about a lot, but it really is a big thing.
Yeah, and in a future episode, we're actually going to dive into that a lot deeper, you know, traders' mentality, psychology, because I agree with you, it is a huge part of trading. And I did want to, before we move on, I wanted to ask Rafaela's opinion on averaging down, because it seems to be a debated thing across traders, whether or not averaging down is ever okay. So what is your opinion on it?
So it really depends on the stock, whether I would average down or not. If I have conviction that it'll go back up like the next week or so, then yeah, I would average down. But most of the time I just let it go and I move on to another ticker, because in this market, like, you never know, like, when the dip will stop dipping. Like, you just don't know. So I don't really average down too much.
Yeah, and I think if you ever do, like, I don't know if it would necessarily be averaging down, but like, say you're buying a swing in demand, like, you can plan out your entry is, you know, starting at the demand zone and then adding down until it ends, and then if it breaks that demand, cutting it. So kind of having that, like, planned out scaling in to a swing stock, right?
Right.
And Aria was telling us a little bit about this, and I think I cut her off to let you into the meeting again. Aria, do you want to finish what you were saying about averaging down?
So to continue what you just said, to pick levels, if you want to average down, they say, you know, 200 moving average on the daily is where you can comfortably enter in a trade. So if you are adding, please make sure it's on some support moving average. And otherwise, I'm personally very much against averaging down, like, very, very much. So I would recommend if someone wants to average down, to only give themselves one chance. So we know how addictive trading can get. I've blown up accounts in the past, averaging down more than once. So you know, tell yourself before you average down, I have one chance. Is this really the time I'm going to decide to do that or not?
Yeah, you don't want to just keep adding to your bag, right?
I never add to your account. That was another big mistake that I did as a newbie. If you cannot make it with your small account, you adding more money to the account is not going to change anything except your donation to the stock market.
Yeah. And I guess that's a good last question that we'll end the night with. Did you guys start under PDT, over PDT? I mean, you don't have to give us an exact number if you're not comfortable, but if you want to just tell us if you started over or under PDT. Meg, do you want to start?
Sure. I started under, for sure. I was still in college, so it was like, I really put all that I kind of had together. But it became very addictive. And I know you're not supposed to add to an account, but for me, it became like every little bit of money I got, I was just putting it into my trading account. And
I think Aria means like, if you keep, like, you know,
losing,
hemorrhaging money. Yeah, exactly.
And then putting it in and it doesn't, I've done that.
That's what I did too.
I've done that once. And then you, it's weird because you're like, then you don't feel so bad, right? Because it's like, oh, you don't see your loss on your account anymore, but it's a terrible habit. Terrible.
Yeah, stop that. You have to be able to make it, you know, to new traders, you have to be able to make it with whatever you got, even if it's like, you have $50 left or $100. It doesn't matter if you're under PDT rule. You know, unless you've made some significant change to be a paper trading, you know, a lot of people just continuously add every couple of weeks. And that's certainly not the way to go.
And how about you, Rafaela? Did you start over or under PDT?
So I started under PDT. I started with 5,000. So it was difficult at first.
All right. Thank you both so much for coming and talking with us. Honestly, I think that your stories were both amazing. I loved hearing the inspiration behind it. And I love how real both of your stories are, that you're both self-taught, that you kind of had to go out, like we all have, go out and try to figure out where to learn from and what to learn. And congratulations on still being here. I feel like we should say that all to ourselves, that we're still here. You know, good job. we're still in the game, right?
Absolutely. And hopefully having you two on here, it's just amazing to see female traders you can connect to and bond, you know, and on so many levels. Of course, you know, we're the minority, and also because we happen to think the same, we have the same brain structure. So one day maybe we'll have our own all-woman firm. So I'm very excited to know how that would go, because sure, it's nice to have a outside perspective, but I'm also very curious to know how an all-female firm would go. So this is
Aria's thinking bigger and bigger and bigger.
I love it. And also on that note, I hope that, you know, us doing this encourages other female traders to come out of the woodworks, you know.
Yes, that's
it's
that's
okay out goal. Here.
Yeah. Thank you guys for coming on and being honestly an inspiration to me, and I think a lot of new traders who are going to watch this, especially women. It's amazing, and hopefully you guys will come back and talk with us again soon.
Definitely. Thank you so much, guys. You have a good night.
Thank you for having us.
Again, you guys are going to be memorable because you're our first female trader guest. So we're always going to remember you as that. Yay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you guys so much. We'll talk to you again soon.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Bye.
Good night.
Good night. All right, everyone, that is it for our episode tonight of Trader Babes. I hope you enjoyed hearing Megan and Rafaela talk about their trading journey. As a reminder, you guys can now subscribe and download our podcast on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and iHeartRadio. We are coming soon to Audible. And if you can please subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the like button if you enjoyed this episode. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next time. Bye. Want more Trader Babes? Subscribe now and connect with us on social media for exclusive content and access you won't find anywhere else. And we'll see you right here on the next unforgettable episode of Trader Babes.